Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. I know that my Redeemer liveth, and that he shall stand at the light of day upon the earth. And I shall see God, whom I shall see for myself. We brought nothing into this world, and it's certain that we can carry nothing out. The good Lord giveth, and the good Lord taketh, but blessed be the name of the Lord. Hold to his hand, God's unchanging hand, you just hold to his hand.
Change the name. What you got to hold to me?
Yeah, oh, Hallelujah, Thank you. Hallelujah. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. For this is still the day that the Lord has made. And we have a mandate to rejoice even in this. Anybody still got a praise on your lips? Anybody still got a hallelujah? Anybody still got a name for Jesus? He's a God that you can see Jesus. You gotta travel down this road. For those of you that are friends, I just need you to help me lift it up for the family. Amen. Lift up the family, y'all. Lift up their hands. Amen. Amen. Don't let them think they're all right. God's got it. We got something to rejoice and praise God for, because He spared us yet another opportunity to get right today when we didn't get right today. So we celebrate two servants of God on today. And we can rejoice because we know where they are. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And I'm going to end it like this. David declared, let everything that has breath, let everything that has breath praise ye the Lord. We're going to follow our order of service as it is printed in your program. We're now going to have musical selection by none other than Mr. David Scott, followed by God's Holy Word, the Old Testament by Deacon Bonner, and followed by the New Testament by Reverend Roletta Banks. And then we'll have the prayer of comfort by Chaplain Williams in that order.
I have everything. He makes me lie in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will feel no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness, love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. The word of God for the people of God. Family, keep the faith. God will bring me through this. And who is the greatest comfort but our Lord, Savior, Jesus Christ?
Some of us question and solve someone's dilemma in this time of bereavement. For you said in your holy word that you would never leave them nor forsake them. Heavenly Father, we ask you to keep your angels encamped around them during the good days and the bad days. And Heavenly Father, if you do all these things, we'd be ever so grateful and honored to give you all the honor and all the glory shall be done. It is in Jesus' most precious and holy name we pray. Let the saints of God say amen.
Amen. To God be the glory for the great things that he has done. At this time, we will now have the acknowledgments by the representative of the Joseph and Johnson & Son Funeral Home. And followed by that, we will have the church resolution letter by Deaconess Wanda T. Roberts, church clerk of the Big Bethel Baptist Church.
We give reverence to the Spirit of Christ that is present in this place on today. We thank God for the life, both lives that have lived before us. So let's give God praise for the life. This family has been through a lot this week, but our prayers have been answered, and God has given us strength to make it through this day, amen. And they thank God for each one of you who come to support them as they say not farewell, but just see you later, the two angels. On behalf of the family, they are grateful to each of the pastors who are here today, to each of you for taking time out of your schedule to share as we celebrate this life today. They have received several cards of sympathy and letters, too numerous to read on today, but rest assured, a later date, the family will read and acknowledge our cards. In the loss of your mother, every life holds a beauty of its own. Every memory helps the beauty to live on. Praying memories, love, and God's grace and comfort to give you strength. Deep sympathy, the Dinwiddie High School class of 1979. To the Hall family, in the memory of your mother, asking God to gently comfort you, strengthen you for the days ahead, and remind you of how much you love. From the Bonner family, Billy, Dale, Wilbur, Patty, and the twins. In sympathy to the family, to Ms. Gwendolyn Hall and the entire Hall family. In this difficult time, may you find peace and the love that surrounds you. With deepest sympathy, the Olive Branch Baptist Church Mass Choir, Orlando Hughes, President, Kate Walker, Secretary. Olive Branch Baptist Church, Dinwiddie, Virginia. Trustee Gwendolyn Hall, the entire trustee ministry wishes to give these words of comfort to you. We give you handfuls of warmth and loads of cushion to land on. You are the center of our attention. We shall apply calmness to brighten your light. Our faces, our voices shall seek and hover over you to give you comfort as it falls into place piece by piece. The trusting ministry are aware of the steps that have been placed in front of you. God is walking beside you, and we are walking behind you. Your walk may be long, rough, and tough, yet we are willing to follow you on the path because God is our God, leading us in the right direction. If you stumble, do not fear. Love will pick you up, and you shall continue. Trust a powerful word, and also derives as a finer group of trustees who will find shelter in you into a place of love that you will never depart. Embrace the companionship between God and the trustees as always. Trust in the Lord. Our voice shall be in your ear for you to hear. We love you dearly, trustees of the Olive Branch Baptist Church. My name is Betty Prentice. I met Mrs. Hall in 2006 through her Christmas program. We became very good friends over the years. I am grateful for the time that we had together and blessed that she let me into her life as a friend. Miss Rose was the most encouraging, caring, and loving person that I ever known. She loved God, she loved her friends, and she loved her family. I will not say goodbye, but simply, until we meet again, forever, love your friend. Again, on behalf of the family, thank you to each of you who've come to support this family today. Not only today, but in days to come, they will need your love and your support. I'm reminded of a story, I hope some comfort to the family, a gentleman who had a toothache one day. He called the dentist one evening and said, I gotta get into the office because I can't bear the pain much longer. And the dentist said, well, I can't see you until tomorrow. And he said, what's the most hurting pain that you have? He said, my left side, it hurts so bad I can't even eat my food. I can't swallow anything. The pain is so severe. Well, the dentist said, well, until you can get into the office, I'll tell you what you do. Try chewing on the other side. The man said, okay, I'll try. He told his wife, and he got his food and sat down to eat, and he began to eat slowly. And he said, babe, I believe the dentist is on to something. On the other side, there was pain. On the other side, there was discomfort. Well, I'll chew on the other side. It's all right now. All right. So I say to this family, you suffered a loss, hours apart on last Sunday. But I say to you, both of them, on the other side, the side where all the discomfort and all the pain is gone. On the side where the Bible declares the wicked shall cease from trouble, and our weary souls shall be at rest. A place where there's no more COVID, no more hospitals, no more medicines. But both of them, grandmother and grandson, now rest in the place. Wherever they will be seen, and Sabbath will have no end. So family, when you get lonely, just remember, your loved one is on the other side. Yeah. God bless you.
To the families of the late William Alton Hall, Jr. and Rose Marie Hall, he will wipe every tear from their eyes, and there will be no more death or sorrow or crying or pain. Revelations 24:4. Reverend Alexander Williams and the members of the Big Bethel Baptist Church in McKinney, Virginia, express our heartfelt condolences to the extended Hall families. Words cannot reveal the sorrow and the sadness we feel for the loss of William Alton Hall Jr. and Rose Marie Hall. Wendell, Jamari, Joyce, and the entire Hall families. The love that Alton and Marie shared among the families leave memories that no one can steal. Their lives were a blessing, and their memories will be treasured. They both had kindred spirits of humility. They had a willingness to help others, and they were two servants of God. Allow the legacy of them to serve as a continued bond for the families. Family, hold steadfast to John 6:47 that reads, whosoever believes in me has eternal life. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. 2 Corinthians 5:8. Whereas William Alton Hall Jr. and Rose Marie Hall, they have performed their work on this earth and offered their services to this church for the greater honor and glory to God. Glory to God. be in the spirit of humility. Therefore, be it resolved in the order of the Big Bethel Baptist Church this fourth day of September in the year of our Lord 2022. Humbly submitted, Reverend Alexander Williams, pastor, Wanda T. Roberts, clerk. The Lord will strengthen your hearts and give you peace.
This time we're now going to prepare ourselves for expressions on behalf of Alton by his uncle and his aunt and anybody knew Alton. He didn't say too much. He was just a cool, laid-back kind of dude. He just went with the flow. But if you mess with his mama, his son, his grandmother, anybody in his family, it was some trouble in the city. And one thing about Alton, even though all of us are cousins, we were like brothers and sisters because of the bond that we shared. And even though Gwen is married to the family, you are family, and the whole family, you are still aunt and uncles and cousins. So at this time, we're now going to prepare ourselves for expression. I can bring the mic. See, Alton already playing jokes, cutting the lights out.
Everything I can say about my nephew is right here in this book. And even though he wasn't my first nephew or niece, whatever, I'll start with, he gave me a lot of firsts because he was the first that I actually was there from the beginning. I have another nephew, two other nieces that we kind of grew up together as brothers and sisters. The age is there, but with him, I knew him from the beginning. And what I can say about that is he knew me. So we formed a bond, as you can see in the baby pictures, from day one. And what I can say about that is a couple of moments come to mind. One, at Olive Branch Baptist Church, I was keeping church service, and after service, we go outside, we gather, talk, and it's always Sunday dinner at my parents' house at that time. And Gwen comes to get him, and he wouldn't go with him. And this went on for a few minutes, and finally she said, "Boy, I'm your mama." I said, "He's all right. I got it." And then I can think of days again. We're at the house and we eat right after the church service. So she brings me to the house. I can hear this strange sucking sound. I just never heard this before in the house ever in my life. I said, "Well, what is that?" She said, "Well, he's hungry. He's sucking on his hand." I said, "Well, good grief, you better hurry and feed him, because if you put a hand in there, he might have drawn back a nub." But that's some of the little joys he gave me there, the time we got to spend together. As his uncle, I tell you, growing up, he would come and stay with me from time to time. We have, you know, special moments, and we had time together because he did love his family. That's a very true statement. I don't care where you were in the relationship, whether it was a cousin, an uncle, a niece, or where, a sister, it didn't matter. If you were family, you were family. And if you call on him and say, I need you to do something, he was there.
Yeah.
From 12 years old, and I tell him, hey man, come on, we gotta go cut the yard. You know, talk to the mama. What's been doing? Well, you have to cut the yard. How'd you get into that? I said, hey, come on, man, go cut the yard. And even now, when we get back in this area, I call him or something. Well, I don't know, he might have something to do. I said, well, tell him, call me. Call me up. I said, hey, I need you to do this. He come on over. Ain't no question. He didn't miss a beat. So that's how he was. And yes, absolutely. If you cross his mom, yeah, you had something to deal with. But he wasn't always quiet. As a matter of fact, as I remember him, he is quite the life. Quite the life of any gathering. I won't say party, but you make it a gathering, whatever it is, he's quite the life. He will keep the laughter going. Just naturally funny to make you laugh. And it's always the small things. I don't remember him as big things, necessarily being so important, but those family moments, being together. I think he would want everyone to know that he loved, and if you got in his heart that he loved you, it was a special relationship. I think that he would want them to also know the part about being dependable, you can count on him. If it's for fun and it's the right thing, you can count on him. If it's for you in trouble and you need help, just call. I'm telling you, he will be there. And absolutely, he wants you to know, if you mess with my family, I'm going to protect him. And definitely don't get sideways with your mom, because those two, not only were peas in the pot, they had a special father as mother and son. And I can tell you, I had one with my mom. I'm going to tell you, they had a special father with mother and son. So, the last thing I'd like to share with you and get off the stage here is, so you never know how things work out. So, he recently graduated from college. Well, he had already graduated, but he wanted to march. With COVID and all that, he didn't get to march, and he felt a little cheated. So he really wanted to march, so he invited the family to go, and we went. Well, the family went, and so last Saturday, I got his thank you card in the mail, so didn't really know what it was, because it wasn't quite impressive what it was. Oh, I must have a card for somebody. Open the card after being out in the yard working all day. And it's from him. So, thankfully God put it on my heart not to wait. So I said, I'm going to contact him today. I appreciate him taking that time again to say he appreciated me, because I appreciated him, those little things. So I did contact him. Thankfully I did, because if I had put it off until Sunday, that just wouldn't have happened. So.
First, give an honor to the triune God, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, to the pulpit guests, to my family,
our
family. We're all one. And isn't it unique how Grandma Hall and her grandson have led us all together, not for a greeting, but for a celebration of life? Because Mama Hall, Grandma Hall, great-grandma Hall, great-great great-grandma Hall was a woman of wisdom. She was a virtuous woman. She was worth more than her weight in gold and more precious than rubies. And Alton, not only was he our nephew, my nephew, but I always called him my first son, because when Gwen had him in 84, I was as happy as I could be. And you know, Alton was a provider. He loved Jelani, and he would do anything for Jelani. And for his mother, he always knew you loved him. And you better not mess with him. But I gotta tell y'all something, you better not mess with me. Because he would come to my rescue. I told him one day, I said, you just like God, long time, and if I call, you'll come. And he would be there. He would do anything for us. We love two very valuable, loving people. But you know, I have to lean to Habakkuk. I have to pray to God, and I do for him to get me to understand what took place. And family, it's all right. Because as Wendell said, on the other side, they're all right. They got Alton, they got an invitation to join the Lord on August 27th. His grandma, a few short hours, got an invitation, Joyce, Pete, and Bonnie, to join all of them on August 28th. Now, none of us can say why God did what he did. But you know God is sovereign. He doesn't make a mistake. So Alton, the great entertainer, and don't you dare forget this, he's a great griller. He's a master griller. Mama Hall is a master cook. I hope y'all got some of the recipes before she left you. Because no more is the family dinner on her. It's on you all. But you know what? The master of us all, God the pilot, his son Jesus the co-pilot, called them home. And they got their wings and they took flight. They're all right. They're all right. In times like this, we need a Savior. Weeping will come, but it's only for a night. Joy cometh in the morning. And take joy in the fact that they were both Christians and they loved the Lord. And God loved them best. And they're home now. They're home, safe in his arms. I love you, family. And take care and stay with God. He's the only one.
Mr. Alton Paul. Tears away, yeah. God is. And we bless God for how God has continued to keep us. I want to take this opportunity to express my heartfelt appreciation initially to this family, but to Brother Alton's pastor. You heard Pastor Will share, and I want to let him know publicly and personally that this is a great honor for me to stand and briefly speak well of our beloved brother, but to also extend words of comfort to this family. Most of you had the privilege, and I take this opportunity to acknowledge the entire Hall family. Although I stand to share words of comfort as we reflect and celebrate the life of Alton, I do want to say to the entire family that our prayers are with each of you. Many years ago, I had the privilege to be introduced to this young man, and I know today that you might believe or feel that 38 years is not long enough, but 38 years is enough time to get to know someone. The Bible says he who desires to have a friend must first show himself to be friendly. So today, as we celebrate this life, I didn't know him by his formal name. I only knew it as Alton. That was good enough for me because he wasn't the type of guy demanding that he be addressed a certain way. And I realize that many of us that are gathered here, gotten to know over the years him in a more closer relationship, but I thank God for the time in which I had to spend. You may be wondering how not only would we come across each other's path, but even before I share with this family what I believe some of the greatest words of comfort that has ever been written in God's Holy Writ, you wonder how I would be able to come and stand and speak well of him. Because I've come to the realization that it doesn't take a long time to get to really know someone. Well, Alton was, as it was stated, his pastor shared the recommitment. One of the things worth celebrating is that he was in receipt of something, and he recommitted to something. He was in receipt, as his obituary suggests, the gift of salvation. Not everybody got it, but everybody can get it. He received it, so we celebrate his receipt. But not only do we celebrate his receipt, I'm even more impressed by his recommitment. When you take that opportunity to recommit, you're saying, God, if along the way I've failed or faltered, I vow to you to recommit my life. And that's why we can celebrate, although 38 years may not be as long as we desire. Can y'all do this? Can we put our hands together and bless God for the life? Family, this is included in the letter which has been sent to the family, presented to the family today, it includes this particular passage of scripture. Psalm 147, verse 3, he healeth the broken in heart,
yes, sir,
and bindeth up their wounds. I want to talk about there's a fix for this. There's a fix for this. When we explore, reflect on life, most of us have aspirations and desires, who we want to be and where we want to go. And I believe that Bob Alton had desires and aspirations. And for many of us gathered here today, perhaps we would suggest that maybe he did not attain or reach, or he was not able to complete those aspirations and those things that he desired to fulfill in his life. But as you heard his aunt say, God is sovereign. And I believe he's more wise than all of us together. The psalmist helps us today with these words. Those that might be familiar with Psalm 147, it begins with something that distinguished about the writer, the psalmist. The psalmist is praising God. Yeah, Psalm 147, he's praising God through song. He's praising God, and he's expressing his appreciation for God. Praise ye the Lord, for it is good to sing praises unto God, for it is pleasant and praise is coming. What does this have to do? There's a fix for this. Let me suggest to you, it seems as though the tides have turned between verse 1 and 2. Verse 2, the psalmist would suggest that the Lord doeth build up Jerusalem. So he goes from acknowledging, praising God, and singing songs of praise, to now realizing that the nation needs God's help. Yeah, let me suggest to you that Alton is not exempt from experiencing the same challenges all of us experience. We live in a world that presents problems and tribulations and trials. And so the psalmist says, after he acknowledges that God deserves the praises, yet he desires to sing praises to God, the Bible says that he mentions that God has to build up a nation, and it says he gathered together the outcasts of Israel. Here's my point here. He goes from singing praises, acknowledging the supremacy of God, thanking God for his goodness, to now realizing that God has the ability to help collectively. We're here together today. God has healing for us collectively.
Right.
But I didn't come here just for us collectively. I'm here to suggest that there's a fix for this, and I'm speaking to us individually. Watch the text. He healeth the broken in heart. We're talking about God, y'all. And if you ever wondered if this situation can be fixed, if the heart, if the hurt, if the anger, if the frustration, if the desolation can be healed, I promise you there's a fix for this.
Yeah.
And because he says he healeth the broken in heart, God here is exhibited as being Jehovah Rapha. He's a healer. For those of us that have ever gone through situations where we hurt so much that only God can heal, you do understand some things can only be fixed by God. So in case you're wondering how difficult this might be, there's a fix for this. Bible says he healeth the broken in heart. What I like about the fact he heals the broken in heart, all of us have experienced some challenges, but today, collectively and individually, many are broken in heart. King James Version did say broken hearted. See, some of us can be broken hearted by little things. Some of us can be broken hearted because your store closed early. Some of us can be broken hearted because your boo stopped being your boo. Some of us can be brokenhearted because somebody looked at you some kind of way. But he said broken in heart. It's a devastating thing to cause you to be broken in heart. But there's a fix for this. Because the Bible says he healed that.
Yeah.
Let me suggest to you, family, God is a healer.
Right.
He's been a healer.
Yeah.
He will be a healer.
Yeah.
The Bible says he's God and he changeth not. So if he healed before, he can heal again. But this is really where, when I think about the fact, Brother Alton, and I wanted to share this. You heard his uncle talk about his graduation and the privilege that I'm given today as I prepare to get out your way is that over the last 6 months, I spent more time with Brother Alton than in the last 6 years. And that might not mean anything to you, but perhaps this was God's way of keeping us connected. Perhaps this was God's way of giving me a privilege to spend time with this young brother. Yeah, graduation. Told his mom, asked his mom, because I know he didn't tell his mom, and he asked to give Pastor Nolan an invitation to his graduation. Got the invitation. Guess what I did? Showed up at the graduation. And guess what he said? I need you to come. Imagine how I feel. You heard his pastor talk about the respect. He said, I knew you would come. He said, I asked you to come because I knew you would come. That's the type of relationship we're building, didn't I? Many months later, we were together at a function in the community in celebration and talking about basketball. But the one thing he said, I just want to let you know, I appreciate the fact that you showed up. I appreciate the fact that you honored my request. Let me suggest to you, people don't have to be nice.
Yeah.
He was expressing, and this exhibited the type of person he was. And I know all of us know him in our different capacities, but I know him to be one of the nicest guys because when he wanted to be nice, he was nice. You didn't have to keep bringing it up, so guess what he said? He said, listen, people don't have to be nice, but let me suggest to you, even when they're being nice, they don't have to be nice to you.
Right.
A few months later, the most recent wedding that I performed, guess what? We were together. And you want to talk about a young brother with influence? He shared with us his favorite restaurant. He and his mother convinced his mother to take him every year for his birthday. And they hadn't been, so he talked about it so much while we were at this wedding that my wife and I decided to go to the restaurant. The last restaurant that we've eaten at was because of Brother Alton. That's influence, y'all. Some folk I listen to because I have to. But I listen to him because I wanted to. Let me suggest to you, as we celebrate his life, how can we be helped in this situation? How can we be certain that there's a fix for this? Because the psalmist says, not only does he heal the broken in heart, but the psalmist goes on to suggest and bindeth up their wounds. This word bindeth, its original language, means to bring together, to tighten. Let me suggest to you, this is what makes God so awesome in moments like this. Did say that the wound would go away. Did say that you wouldn't have scars from the wound. But it does suggest he'll tighten it up. And he'll tighten it up to the fact that it will not be painful anymore. That means that we're not going to miss him. That means that we're not going to long for his physical presence. But when God fixes a thing, it's fixed, y'all.
Yeah.
To the degree that not only can he heal Jehovah Rapha, our broken hearts, broken in heart. But finally, we suggest that as a fix for this, because he knows how to bind our wounds. And family, this is a wound. But let me suggest to you, we serve a God that knows how to tighten it up and bring it together. You do understand that a tourniquet is a device that's often used when someone is profusely bleeding. And the purpose of the tourniquet is to be able to secure the limb so that excess blood will not flow and that individual will lose everything. Rather lose a limb than a life. Let me suggest to you that this psalmist helps us understand because he says there is a fix for this. thank God for the 38 years. We thank God for his demeanor. We thank God for his character. We thank God for his impact. We thank God for the mere fact that he was loved by his mama and he loved on his son. But God knows everything. And what God knows is most needed now. Alton doesn't need God's help anymore. Because Alton has cut through the cemetery on his way home. You do understand that all of us have to cut through the cemetery in order to make it home. And I'm simply here to suggest, family, there's a fix for this. How do you know, preacher? Because if he did it before, he can do it again. How do you know there's a fix for it? Because God knows our hearts. God knows what's heavy, what's upon us, what's burdening, what is burdensome to us. God knows what's causing our bereavement. But can I help somebody today? The good news is that he doesn't just know what we're going through, but he knows how to fix it. He knows how to heal our broken hearts. He knows how to bind up our wounds. And before I take my seat, can I suggest to you, I thank God that even right now, God knows how to fix this. How does he know how to fix it? Because he's God. And he's God all by himself. And I just believe there are few folk in the house that's going to be steadfast and unmovable and trust the fact that God's going to fix this. Anybody believe God knows how to fix it? Well, our Savior prepares for that. And one of the conversations with Brother Alton, in his own quiet demeanor, he suggested in his quiet way, he wasn't one of those that's going to try to prove to you he believed. But when you said something to pique his interest, he would agree with you. And I just believe that God decided in his own infinite wisdom to be able to say, Alton, you don't have to worry about this life anymore because you have the receipt and you have recommitted your life. Then celebrate in the glory of the Lord. You do understand that heaven is a place for prepared people. It's a prepared place. God prepared it for prepared people. And let me suggest to you, the fixed family is that God has orchestrated it. God has designed and God has made a way so that all of us can get the fix, y'all. All of us have an opportunity to get the fix. That's how he fixes it up. So Sister Gwen, let me suggest to you, God knows how to fix this. Family, let me suggest to you that God knows how to fix it. There is a fix for this. And what can you leave us with? Hold on to God's unchanging hand. Can you understand that God has not left us nor forsaken us? He's got a fix for this. And let me suggest to you that I hold on to the promise that God said he'll never put more on us than we can bear. And there ought to be at least 5 witnesses in the house that would suggest that I trust that God is going to fix it. Can I tell you how he does it? He wipes away teary eyes. Can I tell you how he does it? He mends the heart. He heals the heart of those that have their hearts broken. And I thank God today because as we celebrate his life, we thank God that God has the fix for this. So hold on, family. Because God has the fix for this. How does he fix it? Psalmist tells us he knows how to heal broken in heart. And he knows how to bind up our wounds. That alone would suggest that God is a fixing specialist. He got this. God bless you.
This time we're now going to prepare ourselves for reflections for Auntie, my granddaughter, which we are, and she makes her way up. Anybody knew and really knew that if you were ever in her presence, you were going to leave laughing, maybe crying, even a little upset. My aunt was a trash talker. She loved to have, I'm just going to keep it real. Hello. She said, Pastor, she but she let her know I like the name. She said, Pastor, she said, whatever you do, after you finish dancing, don't sit down and cross your legs. I never understood what that meant. And when my 12th grade year of school, I had work study. That means I could leave school early. And my mama didn't drive, and my daddy sure won't pick me up. So my Aunt Reed said, I'll pick you up. She'll pick me up every day from Dinwiddie High School. And I believe during the time she picked me up, every shirt was on lunch break. Because from Dinwiddie County High School, Courthouse Road, all the way to McKinney, the tree was laid down. 55 to 75. She was a little frisky thing, that's all I'm saying.
Stepped up and he put those shoes on and
Come on, is there any bodies? That's the one. If you're leaving right now, God is standing by your side. I know you're grieving. I know you're hurt, but guess what? He said he will never leave us, nor will he forsake us. He'll be right by your side. The hour has been well spent. And I'm going to hit it and I'm going to quit it.
All right.
I'm going to get in your way and out of your way. My aunt, she loved to have a good time. Even in the wheelchair, she still loved to have a good time. She would often say, Pastor, don't let them folk change you. Don't let them folk kill you. You get you some rest. The family after today get you some rest. There's a whole lot I can say about my mom. But she's made it home now. She's over, our family has gone through a whole lot. And as I sat there and thought about what could I say, a whole lot began to come to my mind. And I need one of my co-workers standing out there, give me a time to give me 10 minutes. And when I hit that 10 minutes, you go like this here, all right? All right. Don't make me out a liar, amen? My heart said, two things she ain't like, a liar in a room. Seeming to be a little different in her life. Know all of us got to go one day, but we don't want to see our loved ones go. And she made a statement to her daughter. She said, Joyce saying, I just want to go home. We're thinking that she want to go back to the little house down there in the bottom behind the old school. Then the past week, everybody that came to see her the weekend, she told him, y'all come back Sunday. And I believe that she knew that her time was winding up. We went in on Sunday to let her know about her grandson, but little did we know Alton had already stopped by the house and told Grandma, enough of this old weary work. I need you to go with me. And my mind began to go back to a story in the Bible of the prodigal son, not that they had sinned, but the prodigal son said, I just want to go back to my dad's house. And I believe today, in her mind, we were thinking she wanted to go back to her physical house. But auntie wanted to go back. She wanted to go home. And if I could, just for a few moments, just use for a thought or a subject, it would be better when I get home. Can anybody testify that it would be better when you get home? My brothers and sisters, if you've ever been on a trip, you can stay at the best of the best of hotels. You can sleep on the best of the best mattresses. And you can drive and sit in the nice of cars and walk on the plushest carpet there is. But we all have said to ourselves that there is no place like home.
Make a ruler over many. And you see, Auntie didn't live in a big fancy house like
enough. I had nieces and nephews and cousins. It was hot in the house, but nobody cared, because at the end of the day, it was love in the house. It was love in the house. If the house only had two beds, three bedrooms, a kitchen, a living room, and a bathroom, but we were packed in there like sardines. We had the window lifted up. Some folk was outside, but guess what? The food never ran out.
Love.
as I leave y'all, my mind went to a story. And it'll be better when I get home. And y'all reminded of the story. See, my uncle, he was a mechanic by trade. You know, he was a jack of all trades. You know, he liked to work on cars. And, you know, folk would bring cars to him. And one day there was a man, y'all, who was in a car accident. And the car accident was so bad that the mechanic opened the car, had to have a conversation with the adjuster. It was at that time that the adjuster asked the mechanic, and he looked at the, could he take a look at the car, and the mechanic said, sure, I can do it. So the mechanic asked him to look at the trunk of the car. And he asked him, are we able to use it? And the mechanic said, no, because the trunk is pushed into the back seat. The adjuster said, well, can we use the tires? Can you check the tire station and see if they're any good? And the mechanic, Pastor Norman, said, no, we can't use the tires because they're worn down to the treads. And the adjuster said, well, can you check out the steering wheel? Maybe we can use the steering wheel. And the mechanic said, no, we can't use that either because it's jammed into the car wheel. And the adjuster said, I need you to do me one more thing. And the mechanic said, sure, I'll do whatever you want me to do. He said, I need you to go back to the car and I need you to lift up the hood and check out the engine. Can you find out if the engine is usable? The mechanic went and looked and said, yes, the engine is good. Well, the adjuster said, I need you to do me a favor. And he said, I need you to jump the body and send the engine back to the one that made it. And early Sunday morning, my God and unto you began to have a conversation. And God took a survey of a situation. Saw that she had some good days. Saw that she had some bad days. He took an adjustment of Alton's situation. Knew he had some issues. He had some problems. But God said, don't worry about it. Jump the body and send the man and send it back to me. And my brothers and sisters, be here today. Because Alton and Maria, they made it home. Free at last. Free at last. Thank God Almighty. Yes, free at last.
But this recession ain't gonna be our flyway and
Soon and very soon we're going to see a king. Because my favorite song, we can't play it in church. And Alton kind of music, we sure enough can't play it. Can't play it in the church, but we will go out and rehaul an Alton Hall style. Right. So if you got a problem with it, you better keep it to yourself. That's the problem.
Thank you.